Hi, Brian. Welcome to the Digital Slice podcast. How are you today?
I'm doing well. Thank you for having me.
Oh, thank you. I really appreciate it. I'm looking forward to talking to you today. Why don't we start off with you just telling us a little bit about yourself?
Sure. So I, like our agency, am in Indianapolis, Indiana. So just some good Midwestern roots. I am a marketing nerd by trade and career. I have spent most of my life in all things digital advertising. When I am not working, I am not focusing on digital advertising at all. So I guess I'm a 9-to-5 nerd a little bit. Love a good craft beer. I'm a fan of a bunch of sports teams that annually underachieve my expectations. And my wife, 4-year-old son, and I just love this Midwest life that we have. And you know, it's kind of where we've put down roots for the last many years. So that's me in a nutshell.
That's great.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have a sports team that I like quite a bit that has been underperforming for many years now. And there's a glimmer of hope on the horizon for this year, but I'm kind of one of those, when I see it, I'll believe it.
It's a lifestyle, right? It's people ask me, why do I put myself through this? Because I wouldn't know what else to do with myself every fall come kickoff time if I didn't put my heart, soul, and energy into being disappointed.
Exactly. So I noticed that you have a tagline that says, changing what's possible in digital marketing, which sounds like an enormous focus to me. So maybe you could break that down a little bit for us.
Sure. It's a lot of pressure, right? Sometimes I wonder why did we write that for ourselves anyway? But you know, since StatWax was formed and since I've been doing this many, many years, there have become some just sort of misnomers and some kind of lazy ways out in the loopholes when it comes to digital marketing. We talk to so many potential clients who say, you know, I'm with an agency or I've got a marketing team, and they just say, well, you can't really accurately see this, so you can't fully measure that. There's too much noise. There are too many gaps, and we have to be on paid search. We have to be on LinkedIn. Well, why? Well, because that's what the marketing book says, because I'm a B2B company or something. And that's what we're really trying to challenge, is the idea that, you know, every agency or every digital team speaks about these things in the same way. Oh, Facebook and Apple are in a tiff, so this just can't be tracked, and we're just going to ignore that part of the data, the reporting. And yes, maybe sometimes, you know, we can't undo what Apple does or something like that, but there are always other ways to look at things. There are always other ways to test and strategize. And so we're trying to challenge that notion that the digital playbook is sort of a one size fits all. If you want customers, go on these platforms and test these things. And there's so much untapped opportunity out there that's just, for a variety of reasons, not being looked at right now.
Right. Oh, I love hearing that. It brings back memories of when I started my agency, which was now 12 years ago. I had all the nice little packages and everybody could sign up. And like maybe 3 weeks in, I realized, well, this doesn't fit. There isn't a package for anybody I've talked to in the last 3 weeks. Mm-hmm. They all don't need, you know, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, and YouTube. This company needs YouTube, and this company needs LinkedIn. And when it came to the social media marketing, I got rid of those packages before the first month and started talking to people about, you know, what is it that we can do for you? What do you really need? Where are your customers? How can we help you reach them? So you work with search engine marketing, search engine optimization, conversion rate optimization. You work with SaaS and B2B companies, is that right?
That's correct.
So with regard to the B2B companies that you work with, can you give me an idea of the kind of tactics that you're implementing with them?
Definitely. You know, for us, and what you said is so true. It's a recognition right off the start that what worked for even a very similar sounding one or a similar customer base is not necessarily going to work for this brand. There's so much in play that has built or not built awareness, that has created thought leadership and trust and maybe the sales process looks different, that the one thing that we make sure we do is start by diving into like, what is the data and what is their existing customer base able to tell us, road mapping that ideal journey. So when you said, you know, you realized early on, this company's journey might look different and they need these touch points, and this one might actually need Facebook, but for another company, Facebook might never be touched. For us, it's diving in first and saying, what can we glean with your analytics, with your CRM data, whatever it may be, to try and determine the touch points that mattered most. And so that was a big shift for us many years ago, similar to what you outlined, of moving away from saying, hey, you signed on at this price point in this ad spend, you're going to get LinkedIn, paid search, remarketing, and some display. And instead putting that, you know, well after, you know, put the cart behind the horse, so to speak, and look and say, your best customers, your best revenue and lifetime value, when they came through and submitted a lead and talked to sales, they were watching this product demo video. They were downloading this white paper. They sat in on this webinar, and maybe in Google Analytics, we can ascertain they went to these pages and came back this number of times. Sometimes that's there, sometimes that's not. It depends on what's been tracked. But if we can start to build that map of the best customers or the most likely customers really need to see these pieces of content and have this conversation in this order over this span of time, that will allow us to reverse engineer the ideal strategy. Oh, great. There are three pieces of thought leadership in play. Let's explore a carousel ad that displays all three at once and lets them choose their journey. Which channels let us deploy an ad format like that? Facebook and LinkedIn. But what is the audience? Well, they're CMOs of companies of this size. Well, that's a LinkedIn targeting availability. Let's not touch Facebook yet. Like, and start to kind of build the touch points that way. There are always opportunities where we'll say, yes, if the budget's healthy, let's see what's on paid search. Let's explore the different ways of remarketing. But our main goal is to make sure we kind of discourage the viewpoint of, oh, I sat on this webinar that said I must be paying for LinkedIn right now. Why? Well, I don't know. They just said LinkedIn is where the buyers are at. Okay, let's unpack that a little bit. Let's see, is that truly where your best customers have started engaging with you? Is it truly the ad format and the targeting that best matches the cohorts that we need to go after?
Right. So if I'm a company that wants to work with you, in order for you to dive in and get that information, what do I already have to have in place?
So I guess the short answer is, if there's nothing in place, we can work to figure something out. We try and be strategists first. And we do have startups who come to us and say, I think I know my target buyer. And we can sit down and try and map out what that type of person is looking at and doing, just based on what we know in the space and everything. If you're going after, you know, enterprise level CMOs, we know some of where they can be found. They chat in certain closed off Slack groups. You know, they attend certain high profile webinars. They have sponsorships with it. Like, we can build that. But the ideal is you at least have some sales conversations under your belt where you've been able to ascertain why and why not are people buying or not buying from us, so that we can craft messaging against those pain points. Who are the different decision makers involved in the process? Typically, the best fit is if we go into a CRM and we see a company that is on the client roster, there might be three or four folks of different titles and lanes tied to that customer or that opportunity, because the CMO may sign off on the eventual contract, but it started with maybe the account executive looking for a solution to make his day more efficient. And he found a tool and brought it to his director of marketing, who eventually looped in the CMO. Yeah. We want to best understand, we're not paying to target the CMO who's never heard of your company. We're paying to target the boots on the ground folks and get them demoing the product. And once they tell the CMO, hit him with brand trust touch points and pricing materials. And that's what we're really trying to figure out. So ideally, there's at least some insight from sales specifically about who have they been engaging with along the way and what conversations have helped kind of move the needle each time.
Right. And then I'm guessing it would be helpful to have at least like Google Analytics on your website and.
Yes. That's a great point. In terms of getting into the weeds on the actual numbers and data, Google Analytics, as much history there is possible, is awesome. And we don't care what the CRM is. If you're tracking it in a manual Excel file, so be it. That's item one to fix. But, you know, as long as there's something there, HubSpot, Salesforce, homegrown, what have you. Ideally, some milestones are being recorded, because what we want to see also, in addition to the website analytics, is those who you closed and those who you lost, at what points were things happening? How long on average is it taking you to make your first contact after I indicate I want a demo? Or after the demo conversation, how long until that follow-up? We want to kind of ascertain where we might need to plug in and supplement the nurturing a little bit. But the Google Analytics part, even if you're not even capturing lead information yet, if it's all just on the website right now, that can tell us so much. Even if you haven't set up events, conversions, et cetera, by default, GA is going to show us the journey through the pages, what content they're spending the most time on, where you're losing folks. We can start to reverse engineer that roadmap of what seems to be most important to them, whether they buy or not. And that's just a great starting point for any marketing.
Right. So just a quick aside, because I'm going through this a little bit myself. Are you starting to move clients to the new G4?
We are. begrudgingly. This is not a Stavax opinion. This is a Brian Walker opinion. I hate change. I'm an old man who hates change. And like, I shake my fist every time I log into something and it looks different, but that's just me being me. On the whole, marketing wise, GA4 is coming. The switch exclusively to it right now, I think, is end of June. We will see if Google sticks to that, you know, much like right. the whole cookies thing, they keep delaying things a year at a time. I actually communicated with someone just this morning about Google Analytics 4, and I likened it to Google building the airplane as they're flying it. They're sort of like puttering through the air while bolting wings on. It does some stuff that's cooler and more robust than Google Analytics, but it's also missing some features and has bugs and things that you would think had been vetted out already. So what we're doing is we're deploying it, but we're keeping regular Google Analytics running. We'll just have them run in parallel, because ultimately what we want is we want the data in there. So when the switch happens, we at least have a year of history already in there to be making comparisons to, but we are not telling folks to switch their reports and their source of truth to GA4 just yet, because we've still got to iron some things out.
Right. Yeah. We're doing the exact same thing. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I am a big, data person. I tell my prospects and clients all the time that we are making data-driven decisions, that we're not doing the fad or the, you know, whatever you think you read or the conference that you were at. And it sounds like that fits in a lot with what you and your team are doing.
Very much. We love it, because even if it's to our own detriment, you can't hide from the numbers. You can't explain away just raw, hard data facts. And so many times in marketing now, the space, all you have to read is a few blogs and follow some folks on Twitter. And there's so much of feeling and fad, you know, trends, and like, oh, everyone's doing this, let's try this and that. Well, great. Why do you think you should be on TikTok? Where in the data does TikTok show it has produced a quality lead and a closed customer for you? There's a lot of build out of attribution and stuff that go into that. And that's what we really love doing. Because again, if we can build that clean model that shows definitively these strategies and touch points worked and these didn't, we've yet to have a client who, in the face of all that, says, well, I'm going to keep investing in the stuff that's not working. Like, it always becomes, great, let's reallocate to what's actually working. And now tell me, how much more could I invest to still be seeing positive returns? Then it's just pure business numbers at that point. And ultimately, again, we haven't had a client who sat down and said anything other than, my main KPI is make me more money profitably.
Right. Yeah. So are you seeing any any specific trends in digital marketing for the SaaS and B2B companies that you're working with?
Yeah, I think the main trend that's really starting to take hold is, and it fits very well with where we started this conversation, more and more companies and marketers are getting wise to the fact that they must test and diversify into broader channels and broader tactics than they maybe ever had before, because there's so much noise on your typical channels, quote unquote, paid search. I think Google, in their quarterly report says they have more ads appearing on queries than ever before. And yeah, they have more queries taking place, but like there's more and more noise. There's more investment than ever before. It's more mobile first, smaller screen real estate. So it's even harder to get eyeballs on your ad than ever before. LinkedIn has more ad formats to choose from. It's heavier on the noise and competition than ever before. So all of a sudden, I made the joke about something like TikTok, but all of a sudden, folks are exploring, you know, what programmatic platforms allow me to also layer on behavioral targeting and hone in on audiences and get into ad networks that I hadn't explored. What native ad content can I get, you know, involved in on specific website placements? Are my buyers on Snapchat now? TikTok has a lead gen ad format that they claim loads something like 9x faster than the average landing page. Like they have specifically engineered an ad format to capture lead information for non-e-com advertising. And that's a huge change in direction from what most people think TikTok is for. Now, granted, we've only started testing into it when the budgets allow for it, but I think the biggest trend that we've seen and the biggest thing that we tell clients that is smart is take your ad budget, take your marketing budget, carve out some piece. It doesn't have to be six figures, five figures a month, but some piece of it just to test new things that you otherwise would not have explored. And don't hold that immediately to your main KPI. You're not going to test a brand new platform and immediately see, you know, positive return on investment, positive revenue. But it's if you have your reporting built out and you have your analytics in place, you'll be able to start to measure the trickle-down effect. And the only way you're going to avoid the paying more to play in these competitive spaces and test into new stuff is if you're not afraid to put a little bit of budget and measure out and give it time to see what it does for you in the long run. If you pause it on day two because you didn't close a customer right away, it's not branded search. That's not going to happen right away. And you're forever going to be stuck in these two channels that are just flooding and flooding with more and more competitors.
Right, right. That's great. That's great advice. So if I'm a startup, what advice would you give me as to the kind of data I should be starting to collect right from the very beginning so that I could take advantage of working with somebody like you or, I mean, doing any really real serious marketing at all?
Definitely. Going back to the analytics conversation, what folks are doing on your website is imperative. I think even if you're not spending money on ads, if you're getting anyone to your site who is getting into your system, getting into your pipeline, setting up to capture and track what they're doing and when along that journey. So if you have a lead capture form, making sure you're tracking who is submitting that, because you can go into analytics and there's a section called User Explorer. This is very powerful and not enough people we find are looking at this. It's anonymous number strings. So it's not going to tell you Brian Walker, here he is, but you can click through. And if you're tracking who submits a lead form, you can go and see who did that and expand them. And it'll show you every visit to your site that they had ever made previously and everything that they did. So you can start to look and map out, and it might be manual at first, and there are ways to start to automate the reports. Oh, when people submit lead forms, 9 times out of 10, they first came from this LinkedIn post, or they viewed this solutions page or pricing page. And you can start to ascertain what are the selling points, what are the pain points, what's the information they're looking for. That's where before you spend a penny, we can start to build out what should the messaging be and when. that way you might be on the same channels as a lot of other folks. There's still LinkedIn, there's still paid search, et cetera. But the kicker then becomes, are you proactively addressing pain points and providing solutions and differentiators at the right time and in the right manner that folks were already telling you they need to see it? You're sort of shortening the journey and removing the research and user friction right off the bat. And that can all be done for free before you ever spend a penny, because it's all happening in your analytics, it's all happening on your website organically already. And being able to see things off the bat like that are so, so powerful.
Right. Yeah, I totally agree. And I think having that kind of data sometimes is an eye opener to some of the people that I work with that, you know, are in startups or in early stages. Sometimes they think they know who their target audience is or who their buyer is. And then they start looking at real data and they see maybe something a little different.
Absolutely. ABM is like the hot button. That's been the trend for so long, right? I have this list of white whales that I want to be clients. I'm going to go one-to-one after them. And we often say, okay, why are these people on the list? And eventually it loops back to what we were talking about earlier. They think it's the CMO at these 100 companies. In reality, if we start to dive into the data, talk to sales a little bit, that's another big piece. Breaking down that silo between sales and marketing and understanding the conversation, all of a sudden you start to realize the CMO just signs a contract because three people beneath him spent 3 months vetting it out and telling him this is what we chose. Your ABM should not try and build awareness with the CMO. Build awareness with the person in the weeds who is actually going to be using your platform or looking to save some money out of their own tools budget or something like that. And so it is just changing that mindset of my gut feeling is here's who the buyer is, here's what they look like, and say, okay, what does the data say? Again, you can't hide from the numbers. What is the real truth there?
Right. So you said something that is near and dear to my heart, which is breaking the silos between sales and marketing.
Oh, yes.
Dive deeper into that for me, will you? Because that is a big, it's a big issue for me.
It is. It's a, and do you often find it's like this battle royale between the two?
Absolutely. And when you talk about, you know, data in the CRM, it's like the CRM is for the salespeople and we can't share this information to help you market to get more leads to me.
It's insane. And then ultimately what it ends up is sales is always shouting, well, marketing is giving me crap leads, and marketing is saying, but sales won't tell me what's crap about them, so I don't know how to change that. And it's just like,
right,
man. Exactly. But what we often find is, you know, sitting down with sales and kind of explaining to them how their jobs could be made easier. There's no salesperson who doesn't want to make fewer calls and get more out of them, right? Trimming the fat off of who they have to contact and what they get out of it. And so when we sit down with a sales team and say, well, what if we set it up so when a lead comes through off the website, you can already see that they were searching for this solution and maybe have already watched this demo video. So now you know not to send them that video, because then they're just going to think that, you know, you don't know what you're doing, I've already seen that, and not call you again. Like, what if we armed you with more insight into how to better talk to them so you close them twice as fast? And what if by getting this info from you, we can cut down on the number of people that you try and contact who don't give you the time of day? What could you do by freeing up an hour of your day, you know, each time, and start to frame it that way? And they start to understand that if they give us these couple pieces of information, here's how we can use it to turn around and arm them with more insight to do their job better. So then they're not just thinking we're trying to steal their work and do something in our own silo. We try and make it a two-way street a little bit and frame it as helping them get better. And then also trying to kind of, you know, puff up the sales team ego a little bit and say, hey, you're the ones we want to talk to. Yeah, we talk to the marketing team. We understand the product and all. I want to know what you're hearing, because we can't do what we do because you're the geniuses. We need to know what's in your head. And framing it that way a little bit and saying, no, we do want to hear from you. We do care about. One of the first questions we ask a sales team is, not why did people buy from you? Why did you close that customer? There are plenty of answers there. We know the product. Why did they not? What did that person that was four conversations deep tell you when he ultimately said, hey, we went in another direction. We went with competitor Y. Was it pricing? Did you not have this integration? Was there something there? Because for that cohort, that audience, we'll build out a landing page. We'll build out pain points and messaging and stuff that address that before they ever realize it's a problem. And we'll start to soften that a little bit so that doesn't become a factor that steers them away anymore. And when a sales team hears that we're interested in those things and that we're interested because we're going to start sending them people who talk better and close better, the relationship becomes a little more collaborative, we find.
Right, right. That makes good sense. And I mean, it's just always been a wonder to me as to why sales teams and marketing teams in the same company don't recognize how they can benefit from each other and get locked into these silos and blame and all of that. It's just, I don't know. I'm bewildered.
It's an old school mentality, I think, a little bit, you know, a little bit of distrust over who's using what data. Are they gonna mess with my call notes in the CRM and stuff like that? And so we try and get out ahead of it and just really lay out, no, here's all we want, but here's how it's all set up to help you. We're not trying to make ourselves look better. We're doing our job. If you get better people to call and you close more people, and I'm sure you want to do that too, because I'm sure you would love that commission.
Right. Right. I mean, it just makes sense that, you know, they're going to make more money if they're sharing more information and getting better people to talk to. And I don't know, it goes around in a big circle.
Yeah.
Take a minute and tell us a little bit about StatWax.
Sure. So StatWax is a full service agency. You outlined at the beginning, you know, we do paid advertising. That's kind of our bread and butter, but we do have SEO, CRO, landing page design, kind of all in-house. Ultimately, we have built out the competencies that allow us to say for a client, here's what needs to be tweaked and managed and done in your marketing strategy to produce better leads and more customers for you. And we don't want to be sitting at the table saying, boy, where you're really missing the boat is this landing page could use some work, or your lead capture form should be two stages instead of just one. Like, we want to be able to bring that full sphere of marketing, you know, to the table in the strategy. And we are focused on B2B SaaS. So everything we've been talking about today is we've done e-commerce. There's, you know, there are plenty of e-commerce marketers out there and stuff. We like being able to tell the story of your customer needed three different people and 15 different touch points across 30 days of decision-making, and here's what happened. That's where we really try and build out the reports and the insights and the strategies around. And so that's why we've kind of carved out our lane with that B2B SaaS model. But that's, you know, really what we do. We are a big team of a couple of dozen nerds, all of whom would rather see, you know, some raw data sets all day long than anything else. So
yeah, I love that.
That's what we live and breathe.
That's great. So do you think that there is a way for us to sort of future-proof our digital marketing strategies?
I would definitely say so. I would say, you know, to future-proof it, again, you can't hide from the data. Future-proofing to us means start collecting and cleaning up and getting as much of the data as possible. If you have a lead capture form and you have a CRM, are you grabbing tracking parameters that show you in the CRM where that lead came from marketing, whether it was Google search, organic Facebook post, LinkedIn, whatever, so that when that lead closes to a customer, you can look back and say, that was the channel and that was the keyword that produced it. Capturing all of that, even if you don't know where to start with analyzing or building the reports, just getting all of that clean data, creating that system of analytics that shows you what's happening behind the scenes. Platforms can come and go. Google can change their targeting rules. Facebook can change their audiences all they want. But no matter what, now, a year, 3 years in the future, you'll always be able to look and say, here's what moved the needle for my actual customers. And if you have that, you can always build a marketing plan based on whatever's happening in the different channels and stuff, because you at least definitively know what is resonating with your customers and actually producing revenue for you.
Right. Right. And you mentioned early on how, you know, the change, like the new Apple, the new iOS privacy changes and how that's affected marketing. I mean, every time you open your Facebook marketing, you know, you have the big message across the top.
The red banner.
Yeah, everything has changed and you might not be seeing things and we're working hard to get around this. So you have to kind of be on, you have to sort of have fluid strategies in mind because things definitely change.
Exactly. You have to have enough of the tracking, the data to know beyond just a single touch point, what's making things happen. Because yeah, we could wake up tomorrow and Google suddenly can't use keywords anymore because of a privacy crackdown. That's an extreme, but right. I mean, who would have ever thought, you know, that a complete major mobile operating system would do away with a big piece of what allows Facebook to report and attribute, but it happened. So being ready to still understand the different channels that are in play, even if, you know, one piece of the pie becomes a gray box is so important.
Right. Right. So you've given us a lot of great, great information this morning. If there was one thing that you would want people to take away from our talk today, what would that be?
You know, I think I'll double down on the data nerd side of us and say, don't be afraid of the data. There's so much fear that I'm going to get analysis paralysis. I don't know where to start looking. And that fear often keeps people from just setting it up and collecting it. It's okay if you're not doing anything with it yet, but go and vet out. Do you have the tracking and the data collection in place? Do you have events happening in Google Analytics? Do you have it on your website in the first place? If someone takes a value action, is that being tracked? It doesn't matter if you're not doing anything with it yet, because that's often the holdup for people setting it up in the first place. And where when we come in, we might be 90 days behind the curve just getting that up to speed. So don't let the fear of analysis paralysis and not understanding the data keep you from setting it up and at least having it there. Same with the GA4 conversation that we had. One day you're going to look back and say, man, I wish we had that past year of what was happening to help us make decisions now that we are equipped to do so. So vet that out, get that in place now. You'll thank yourself later when the time comes to start really exploring the more complexities of what can be done digitally.
Right. Great. That's great advice. Well, thank you. Thank you so much for taking your time to be with us today. I really appreciate it. You've given us some great information to think about.
Absolutely. And I appreciate you having me. And thanks for the conversation. Hopefully we made one new nerd out of someone out there. If we've done that, then I've done my job.
Oh, that would be awesome, wouldn't it?